Windows 11 is now being rolled out, and as with every other time Microsoft have released a new version of Windows, the Linux fanboys have crawled out of their basements to tell everyone they should upgrade to Linux instead. Well, here's my laptop. Let's see if they have a point. Welcome back to the Pro Tech Show. To avoid any overly generic interpretations of this video, I'm considering my specific use case on my specific laptop. That doesn't mean the answer will be the same for everybody. To set the scene then, my laptop is a secondary device. I don't do my main work on it or edit my videos on it. I do normal person stuff with it. Browsing the internet, checking my emails, editing a few documents, calling family, watching a bit of YouTube. If you've watched the channel before, you'll know I'm not new to Linux. In fact, some of the most popular content on this channel is about Linux. But I don't consider myself a full-blown expert, and I actually have relatively little experience of Linux on the desktop. Most of my experience is on servers, and servers tend to look like this. I've used Linux desktops, sure, you've seen me do it, but there's a difference between logging on to perform a discrete task and actually living with it day in, day out on your personal device. The last time I did that was about 15 years ago, and yes, now I feel old, thanks. I think this puts me in an interesting position to review the modern Linux desktop experience though. There will be some issues, but I'm familiar enough with Linux that I ought to be able to work my way around most of them. I won't run away when I see a terminal. However, when something doesn't quite work in desktop land, I will have to actually troubleshoot it. Hopefully this means I can give you a balanced viewpoint. The distro I chose was Fedora. I like Red Hat and its derivatives and servers, but they're focused on server use cases and a bit slow moving. Fedora is more cutting edge and has more packages readily available, so I think it makes a lot of sense for a desktop install. I don't think it's stable enough for server use. I've had a few minor crashes over the past couple of weeks, so I'm sticking with Red Hat or derivatives like Rocky or Alma Linux on servers, but Fedora is fine for the desktop. How did it fare compared to Windows though? Well, it had its ups and its downs. I'm going to attempt to plot them on a graph as we go so you can keep track. Right away, Linux gets a point for just working, without whinging at me about unsupported processors. It's a low bar to set, but it beats Windows 11 on my 4.5-year-old laptop. It gains another point for the install process. The ability to run live off the USB to check your device actually works with it is a handy touch, and the setup process was much less annoying than Windows. I'm not convinced it was any faster than Windows, but it didn't keep stopping to ask me questions. The Windows setup process peaked about Windows Vista when it got mouse support, and now these days it seems to spend less time actually installing Windows than it does trying to get your consent for data harvesting. Linux just got on with installing the operating system, which is all I wanted it to do. Once installed, our happy graph starts to take a nosedive as we begin setting up all the additional pieces needed to make it work properly. This is one area where Linux struggles. It shouldn't be a major issue if you know your way around Linux, but the sort of problems I encountered are what puts newbies off using Linux. I think it's important to call these out because people are shouting on the internet that everyone should switch to Linux. It's really easy and you don't need any technical skills. I don't agree. There are benefits of moving to Linux, but you do need at least a willingness to learn some technical skills because it's only a matter of time before you hit a problem that leads you to typing commands into the terminal. If you don't understand what you're doing at this point, then you're just pasting commands from random people on the internet, often with root privileges, and that's dangerous. For example, I want my hard drive to be encrypted, but I want it to unlock automatically on boot. The laptop has a TPM, so this should be perfectly possible, and it works in Windows right out of the box. Enabling the encryption was just a tick box during the install, so top marks there, but setting up TPM unlock was a bit more of a mission. To do this, I need to install some additional software and run a few commands at the terminal. The final series of steps looks something like this. A few things of note. These commands are only there to work around a bug. This isn't something I've done before, so I was following online guides. I kept getting errors, but it turned out to be a known issue with this package. The package isn't necessary at this stage though, so I could work around the problem by uninstalling it, setting up the TPM decryption, and reinstalling it. Another thing of note are these numbers. Different guides suggested different numbers. The numbers refer to methods of checking the system hasn't been tampered with. Any combination would have worked, but most of the guides didn't tell you this and just said, copy these numbers. No explanation as to what they were or why they differed in other guides, which I think people will find confusing. This line was missing from a lot of guides, but it won't work without it. And this piece here was again different in different guides with no explanation as to why. Of course, it's your hard drive partition, what's the big deal? Well, the big deal is that the guide I was using didn't say that. It said this. I saw that, knew my laptop doesn't have an NVMe drive, and changed it appropriately. But think about your average Windows computer user. Do they know what type of drive they have? Would they even know that's what this line of text refers to? I think not. I think they'd copy-paste the command, it wouldn't work, and they'd just assume Linux is broken. On Windows, this entire process is automatic and requires zero knowledge. Until Linux is as easy as that, it's going to remain a niche platform for techies, and the year of Linux on the desktop will never arrive. Besides, after doing all of this, the laptop still prompted me for a decryption password anyway. That turned out to be a bug as well. The TPM did actually release the key correctly, and it did decrypt the drive, and the operating system was booting the whole time behind the password screen. If I just waited, then once Fedora got the login screen, the password box suddenly disappeared. Fine once you know, but I wasted a lot of time troubleshooting a non-issue. It also had problems with screen rotation not working until I manually modified the chassis type so GNOME would believe it was in fact a convertible device. On the upside, whilst GNOME may rather stupidly rely on a hard-coded list of device models and ignore the actual hardware signals to say, hey, this is in tablet mode, at least Linux actually lets me change stuff like this. The final issue I had was getting my printer to work. Isn't it always a printer? Fedora came with drivers for it, but they didn't work. I got the driver from the manufacturer, but it had dependencies, and those dependencies weren't in any of the normal repos. When your software is in the repos, Linux package management is awesome. When it's not, installing software is a bollock, because now you're on an internet-wide treasure hunt to find all of the missing pieces. Now let's talk about actually using the desktop. I didn't like the default GNOME experience. I know this is a bit subjective, but just look at the experience of switching between programs. When you minimize anything, it disappears into a dock that's then hidden from view unless you jump out of your workspace and into the activities menu. You can hit the Windows key to make this quicker, or you could Alt-Tab through. But if you intend to use the mouse, which is a perfectly reasonable and normal thing to do, look at how it's laid out. The activities button is all the way up here. The dock is all the way down here. You can't just click from one program to the next like you would in Windows or Mac. You end up jumping your mouse from one side of the screen to the other. Back and forth, back and forth. Who designed this? Fortunately, it is really easy to add extensions to tweak behavior. Installing dash to dock kept the dock visible when I need it. That massively improved the user experience for me. You can make the entire thing look and behave like Windows without too much effort, but I don't want to emulate Windows. I wanted to try the vanilla GNOME experience, just not quite so sucky. For me, adding dash to dock and switching on the minimize and maximize buttons took it from a clunky experience to a smooth one. This ease of customization is a major advantage of Linux, and it regains some points here because although I think the out-of-the-box experience is a bit clunkier than Windows, by the time you've done just a little bit of tweaking, it should be a better experience in Windows. I don't even think that statement is subjective. At the very least, you can make it behave the same as Windows, so it can't be worse. The real beauty of it is that you can tweak it to complement your own particular way of working, and no one-size-fits-all solution is ever going to be as good as that. Okay, so using Linux is actually pretty good. How about performance? There's more good news. My laptop felt noticeably snappier under Fedora than it had been under Windows 10. It had been starting to struggle and Fedora gave it a new lease of life. To make things fair, I also tested a fresh install of Windows 11 and that did improve things as well, so my old install clearly had a bit of the old Windows rot setting in. I'm therefore not going to outright say Linux performed better than Windows. But I will allow it to pick up another point because I do believe it will at least maintain its performance better over time. Windows just seems to get a bit more bloated over time, a lot of which I put down to its lack of proper package management. If you want an example, install Visual Studio, then remove it, and look at how much crud gets left behind because it's not sure if a program might need it or not. It's why I tend to do clean installs rather than upgrades. The Windows in-place upgrade process is fairly reliable these days, but it's an opportunity to get rid of the junk. Speaking of package management, Linux dumps on Windows from near fatal heights here. It's so much better. It kind of needs to be, because with Linux being essentially patched together from hundreds of independently developed packages, if you don't have robust package management in place, then you end up with dependency hell like I had with my printer. I knew it was better going in. Like I said, I'm not new to Linux. Using it on the desktop really drives home just how much better it is. On a Linux server, you can tell your package manager to run an update and that's it, everything gets updated. On a Windows server, you tell Windows to run an update and Windows gets updated. You still need to update the application separately and maybe its database too. It's more work than Linux, but it's not like the Windows experience is unusable. Servers tend to be single-function machines, though. On the desktop, if you have 30 applications installed in Windows, that's probably 30 different update procedures. Seriously, patching everything on a Windows desktop is a pain in the backside. Linux? One command. One single command. And the thing is, I installed Microsoft software on Linux. My goal, remember, is to upgrade my laptop, not to switch my entire workflow over to open source. So on Linux, I installed Skype because that's what my family uses to talk to their grandchildren. I installed Visual Studio Code because I'm trying to standardize on that a bit and sync it across devices. And I installed Microsoft Edge. I know you'll question that. Day to day when I'm working, there are some web apps I use that work best in Internet Explorer. I know, it's nearly 2022. I don't want to switch in multiple web browsers and I don't want to use Internet Explorer. So the best way for me to deal with that is to use Edge, which can open these silly old sites in IE mode and the proper internet in Chromium mode. Edge makes sense on Windows for that reason, and I've got my settings, my extensions, and my favourites set up on it. So the easiest thing to do on Linux is install Edge and sync them across. Turns out the best web browser for me in Linux is Microsoft Edge. Who'd have thought that would happen? The point is though, on Windows, Skype, VS Code and Edge all have different mechanisms for updating. Even though they're some of the better apps and have automatic updates, they're all different. On Linux, it's just DNF upgrade. One command handles all of them and the rest of the operating system as well. Why is Linux better at updating Microsoft apps than Windows is? Seriously, Microsoft, come on! So far, Linux is looking pretty good. Once you've faffed about enough to get it working properly, it's slick, performs well, and it's easier to maintain. Now for some problems. Let's talk about standard office productivity tasks. Editing documents, checking my emails. Microsoft has this whole thing pretty well nailed down, so Linux was always going to struggle by comparison. But even with that expectation set going in, it wasn't a good experience. I essentially replaced Microsoft Office with LibreOffice and Evolution. And to me, it felt like going about 20 years back in time. A lot of that was the look and feel. LibreOffice and Evolution look a lot more like Office 2000 or maybe 2003. Looks that don't equate to features, and for some people I'm sure they prefer it, but for me it was a step back. I found myself just using webmail instead. Ordinarily, I hate using web apps, but OWA versus Evolution when the backend is Exchange, I couldn't warm to Evolution. A lot of the issues I had besides the user experience were less about Linux and more about the fact I was using Linux in conjunction with Windows. For example, one of my issues was OneNote. There is no OneNote client for Linux, so I was stuck with a web app, which is quite limited. There are alternative applications, but I have notebooks shared with other people, and I can't just ask them to change their applications because I want to use Linux on my laptop. I tried using LibreOffice, and initially things seemed to go well. I opened a document, edited it, saved it. But then I opened it up again on Windows, and the formatting was completely screwed. Again, it seems unfair to judge LibreOffice on its ability to edit Microsoft Office documents. If I was only using it for LibreOffice documents, I'm sure it would have been fine. But life isn't fair. Most of the rest of the world uses Microsoft Office, so if LibreOffice can't cope with it reliably, LibreOffice really isn't a lot of use to me. Linux lost a lot of points here because it seriously impeded my daily tasks. If I was working on Linux in isolation, it would have been okay, but that's not the world I live in. I need compatibility with everybody else, and everybody else is using Microsoft Office. The final problem I had was audio. It just sucked. The sound coming out of my laptop was awful. There was no bass and no high-end clarity either. It was like someone had dropped a bandpass filter on the audio and squeezed all of the frequencies. To be clear, my laptop speakers are nothing special. They're just average little laptop speakers, so I wasn't expecting studio quality audio. But it was bad. I can't bear to even watch YouTube videos like this. Bad. I don't think this is Linux's fault. If I plugged headphones in, it was fine. Linux was generating the right sounds, but the onboard speakers were definitely not right. This seems to be down to an application called Waves Max Audio Pro. In Windows, that gets installed automatically along with the audio drivers, and if you turn that off, it sounds just as bad. Dell and Waves have collaborated on this to improve the quality of the audio in this particular device, but there doesn't seem to be any support for Linux. At first, I assumed it was just doing some fancy equalization, so I figured I could tweak it myself, but it's not that simple. I installed EasyFX and tried to target the bass first, as that was a rather obvious difference. EasyFX has a preset for enhancing the bass, but switching it on did absolutely nothing. I thought EasyFX wasn't working, but it was. I verified this with a manual EQ. It worked until it got to about 2000Hz. Anything I adjusted below 2kHz had no effect because it just wasn't being played at all. I dropped every slider above 2kHz and it was like it hit the mute button. Nothing. The meters were jumping around, but the speakers were silent. It seems the Max Audio software is operating at the driver level to enable an additional hardware feature, and without it, the frequency range on the onboard speakers gets limited. Unfortunately, it's completely proprietary, and there doesn't seem to be any way of working around it. I tried Pipewire and Pulse Audio, I tried different distributions from the Red Hat's Debian and Arch families. I tried fiddling around with config files, I tried switching to Ubuntu and pointing at the Dell repos that they host for other laptops that they actually do support Ubuntu on, in case there's a compatible driver floating around in there somewhere. But every combination I tried had exactly the same issue. At this point, I've given up on fixing it. And this is where I come to my conclusion. Linux is more of a faff to get set up properly, but I expected that. Once set up, the user experience was actually pretty great, and it performed at least as good, if not better, than Windows. I found the productivity apps to feel dated, and there were some serious compatibility issues with my normal workflow. These compatibility issues and the terrible audio are what ultimately resulted in me installing Windows 11 instead. At the end of the day, if I can't do my day-to-day tasks or they take considerably longer to do, then it's not a viable option for me. So, is Linux on the desktop just a write-off then? No. I was very encouraged to see how far it's come since I last daily drove it. If I was using almost any other hardware, or if Dell actually bothered to support their devices on Linux properly, then the audio issue wouldn't exist. If I was using a device without proprietary secret sauce in its speakers, and if I wasn't so reliant on Microsoft Office, this laptop would currently be running Fedora. Would I recommend it to others though? If you have or are willing to learn a base level of technical skills to deal with Linux's foibles, you don't interact with Microsoft Office documents all that often, and you don't have a laptop that relies on proprietary Windows-only audio software, you should give Linux a go. It might surprise you. If you or people you work with are deep in the Microsoft ecosystem, or you just want an easy life, you're better off sticking with Windows. Let me know what you thought of the video and give it a like if you found it interesting. Have you used Linux on a desktop, and how have you found it? Let me know in the comments. If you want to know about more scenarios where Linux wins over Microsoft, then check out this video. Or if you'd like to see where Microsoft wins over Linux, then I've got you covered down here as well. Thanks for watching, see you next time.